Welcome to this new webinar, Invest for High Returns and Control Risk with Event-Driven Opportunities. Before we start, please remember our contact details if you need more information about our services. This year at Swissquote, we have celebrated our 25th anniversary, which shows our long experience in online trading. We give you access to the markets with tailor-made conditions. We provide you with our exclusive market analysis. Don't forget that we also have daily videos and podcasts. You can find our Swissquote YouTube channel and additional material available in the newsroom on our website. We offer assistance in several languages. We are trusted by over 400,000 clients worldwide, and we offer all the security of a Swiss bank. We are listed on the Zurich Stock Exchange with over 2 billion market capitalization at the moment. Please always read carefully our disclaimer. I remind you that all the content of this video is purely informative and does not constitute any investment recommendation. I also want to show you quickly our education section in the swissquote.com website. So if you click on education, you access to this page where you can access to some courses, and you have the schedule for the next webinars by clicking here, see all the webinars, and then you can also select your favorite language, of course, and then you can download all the ebooks available on the different topics, so forex, risk management, introduction to stock investing, how to build a portfolio, how to trade with future options, ETF, and cryptocurrencies, and our products teams trading. Our blog, swissquote.com/blog, you can also find here the different webinar recorded with Anand as well. So if you want to review some old webinars, do not hesitate to go here. And visit the gfmfocus.com website. Here you find all the description of the activity of GFM. You can also express interest towards their products. And if you click here about us, you also find Anand that is today with us. So thank you very much for hosting this webinar, Anand.
Thank you, Stefano. And very warm welcome to everybody in the audience. I recognize a couple of familiar names, but welcome again. So I hope everyone can see my screen. I'm yes. Going to begin the webinar. And as with other webinars that we do, this is purely an educational event. Nothing here is recommendation to buy or sell anything. Please take a minute to read this language that our lawyer so kindly asked us to put in. When I'll take a breath and I'll move on, but this should be standard information that you should probably be familiar with if you have been with another webinar previously. Okay, this is me, Anand Bhattipati. I'm based in Hong Kong, and I'm a co-founder and portfolio manager of GFM. Basically, I started GFM because I could not find anybody investing money the way I wanted it to be done. Initially, I didn't even know this was going to be a business. I just wanted to invest full time. Slowly, people that knew me came and asked me to start managing their money on their behalf. That's when we went and became a licensed investment manager and opened up to outside clients. So we've been in business for about between 5 and 6 years now. And so far it's gone quite well, very well. I'm happy with the results of the investing performance and also the way our client base has also started to grow and become quite strong. So what makes us very different? I said we started this business because I could not find anybody managing the money I thought should be done properly. So the first thing is we only do separately managed accounts held in the name of the clients at a third-party institution like Swissquote or someone else. It turns out to be safer, cheaper, and more tax efficient than investing through a fund from a client's perspective. I mean, I can talk for an hour about just this one point, but I'll skip the details for now. We are performance fee only. We only make money when our clients earn a significant positive return on their invested capital. Otherwise, we don't earn a dime, whether it takes a day or a century. Finally, we are principals and not fee collecting investment managers who are there for the percentage of AUM. We invest alongside our clients in every investment that we make. And the institution where the client's account is held in custody and brokerage, they do the portfolio statements independently of us. So there is always going to be a policeman watching over the portfolio. So with this, I'll say that the approach that we take is we try to invest in opportunities where the risk of permanent loss of capital on the downside is small and the upside potential is disproportionately high. It takes us approximately 3 years before we make an investment after we start studying a company and a stock. The goal is to try and double capital every 3 to 6 years. And so far, we've done it every 3.5 years from the day we started. With a bit of luck, I think we'll be coming close to the 3-year mark, doubling every 3 years, which is about 26% after fees, costs, taxes, everything else. So that is an introduction to GFM. Please look at the website and learn more if you feel like you would like to understand a bit more. But on to the webinar itself. I wanted to start this webinar by introducing a few concepts. Some of these concepts may sound strange or controversial to you. That is fine. If you have issues with some of these concepts, I'm very happy to take it up in the Q&A. But for the purpose of the presentation itself, just to get into the spirit, just digest what these concepts are in the background as we go through the rest of the presentation. So, number one, what is investing and what is trading? Investing is about looking at the asset that you buy and looking to the asset itself to generate wealth for you in the form of income and value appreciation. So the best example is you buy a property like an apartment or you buy a farm. Even if you never sell it for the rest of your life, it will grow your wealth in the form of income. Like if you have an apartment, you can generate rental income from it. And as time goes by, hopefully you got it in a good location. And over a period of time, the value of the apartment goes up. Even if you never sell it, you become more wealthy. This is investing. You're looking at the asset itself to generate wealth for you. Trading is about buying and selling. It's more about buying at a certain price and selling it at a profit, or in the case of short selling, the opposite, than it is about what it is that you're buying or selling. So a good example would be day trading Apple stock. You may care about Apple, or maybe you don't even know the company that you're day trading, but all you care about is buying and selling fast enough and well enough that you turn a profit with the activity. This is the difference between trading and investing. So we are investors. And I think it makes a big difference in how you look at investment opportunities and how you assess risk and so on. So that's the first, if you like, cornerstone I would like to put on this presentation and then move forward. So, you know, when I went to business school, the first thing I learned was volatility is risk. Completely wrong. That is a misconception that's been going on since the 1960s, and it is completely wrong. Here's a very simple example. I have two charts on this page. In the first chart on top, you have company number one in blue and S&P 500 in red. And you see on the chart daily fluctuations. What you see is that the company one, is far more volatile, fluctuates a lot more than the index does. So according to finance theory, this is a company which is highly volatile and therefore it's very risky. Okay. Hold that thought for a moment. Look at the second chart. There is company number two in yellow. You hardly see the yellow because actually this company is far less volatile than the index itself. So again, according to finance theory, this is a better investment because it's less risky, fluctuates a lot less, volatility is less. This, I think, is complete nonsense. Volatility is not risk. Permanent loss of your invested capital, that is risk. The harm done for your money, that is risk. Daily fluctuations going up and down, that is not risk. It can become permanent loss of capital if you are heavily leveraged. But like I say in this description below, the choice of leverage is up to you, the investor. It's not about the asset being risky or less risky. It's about your investing approach. So if you're talking about the asset itself, volatility of an asset does not represent risk. And here's why I say this is the case. So keep in mind, company one is a lot more volatile asset. Company number two, stock number two, is far less volatile. And this is the investing result after investing for 25 years. So company one is Amazon, very volatile, but it did generate serious wealth for the investor. Company two, a company called Waste Management. Like the name says, they process and handle waste. It's a very boring, steady business and far less volatile, yes. Predictable, yes, but did not generate money. In this 25-year period, most of the time it underperformed the market, and you would have been much better off just investing in the market than doing all the hard work to try and pick company two, Waste Management. It's just towards the very end it managed to catch up with the market. But in a slightly different scenario, you would have lost money compared to investing in the market, the opportunity cost. So if you invest, the very simple goal of investing is you want to take $1 and turn it into $2 and prevent it from turning it into 10 cents. So if somebody says the risk that your dollar will turn into 10 cents is seen in your smartphone when the prices jump around one up and down, that is not really correct. That what you're seeing there is just volatility. Here's Amazon, very volatile, but generated serious amounts of wealth. So when you are investing, you're looking to generate wealth and you're also trying to protect your capital. So that's the first point I'd like to make. Volatility is not risk. Permanent loss of capital is risk. This is probably a very famous company in Europe now, Wirecard. And a permanent loss of capital is just that. You lose your money and it never comes back. This does harm to your invested capital, to your net worth, to your savings, to the money that you worked hard to accumulate. It just disappears. This is risk. And this is what we avoid when we at GFM try to put money to work. We are very risk averse, and our definition of risk is we want to avoid permanent loss of capital. We really don't think that volatility is risk. In fact, as I will show you in the coming slides, volatility will generate investment opportunities, fantastic investment opportunities, if you keep your eyes open and you have the right frame of mind. So, another concept, what is event-driven investing? So, you know, in a world full of fancy words related to finance, I'll try to make it very simple. What is different about investing in Amazon for 25 years and event-driven investing is this. When you're investing in Amazon and staying there for 25 years, like in the chart, you're betting that the business will do well, the company will grow, its earnings will multiply, and as a result, your investment performance will be good. Amazon is a compounder. It's very profitable, grows very fast, and you know, I had done a previous webinar where I characterized compounders and how we go about investing in compounders. How do we identify them? How do we invest at a safe price in a compounder and so on? So that's Amazon is a compounder. We're not talking about an Amazon. We're talking about an investment opportunity where it's not how well the business does or how the stock market looks or whether interest rates are favorable. It's none of those things that will generate an investment result for you. What will generate an investment result for you is a series of company-specific events. When those events happen, either good or bad things will happen to your investment. It doesn't depend on whether the market is high or low and so on. So this is what makes event-driven investing a different animal than, you know, just staying invested in the stock market or trying to find compounders or staying with them for a long time or looking for arbitrary opportunities or something else. It's a very specific type of investing. And I'm going to talk about event-driven investing because it's worth learning about it and putting it to work, because we have seen time and again with this approach, you find some excellent investment opportunities which keep your money safe and generate large returns. So that's in a nutshell what event-driven investing is. Catalysts are these independent, verifiable, observable, quantifiable, company-related events that you, sitting in your office or in your home with access to public information, will be able to follow and see how these catalysts are unfolding. And as these catalysts unfold, they tend to have a disproportionately large impact on the investment. So, you know, we tend to categorize these catalysts as either financial or operational or competitive. But we'll get into that later. So just keep in mind that event-driven investing and catalysts kind of go hand in glove. So I just, you know, displayed a bit of theory. And what I'd like you to do is keep those concepts in mind as we go through this example that I'm going to take you through. This was a case, an actual investment that we did back in 2012. And it was a company called Hellenic Telecom Organization SA, which is a Greek telecom company. You know, it's a very simple, well-recognized type of a telecom business. Like you have British Telecom in the UK, AT&T in the US, PCCW in Hong Kong. Every country has a national telecom company. And this, Hellenic Telecom, was the national telecom company of Greece. And the backdrop, 2012, was characterized in Greece by the Greek sovereign debt crisis. So as I've put this down in words in the slide, Greeks was close to defaulting on its debt payments. And this was a very big deal. You know, just like you and I need money to live our daily lives, governments need money to operate. And governments raise money two ways. They tax their citizens and they borrow money. So Greece was borrowing money. And after 2008, the amount of borrowing it carried jumped from, it more than tripled to 180% of GDP, a level which brought it close to the level of Japan, for example. And Greece was nowhere close to being able to sustain that level of borrowing. So when the markets became very clearly aware of this, they were worried that Greece will not be able to repay. And as a result, access to fresh borrowing for Greece, the sovereign state, just slammed shut. And they had all these debt payments coming due for which they didn't have money. So they were lurching towards the default. Those of you that were around working at the time probably recall this period when this was big news. The EU, the IMF, lots of negotiation, there was social unrest, there were demonstrations on the street, people were very upset, and there were some real costs. So financial markets were in a panic, and access to debt capital or equity capital to any company or individual linked to Greece was slammed shut. So this was the backdrop. And these were the headlines that we saw every day during that period. So we went looking for investment opportunities. I told you, event-driven investments. We're looking for big changes. Sorry, someone just pointed out they cannot see my screen. Can some, Stefano, can you see my screen? Can someone confirm?
I confirm, Anand, that we can see the screen.
Okay, so thank you.
Everything is fine.
All right, cool. So moving on. So on this slide, as a manifestation of all this financial panic, Greek government bonds jumped from something like 5% yield to maturity to 30% yield to maturity. That, in other words, the bond markets were expecting Greece to default. You can see this in black and white. There's no country on this planet that can pay 30% interest rates and borrow money and still prosper. It's just not gonna happen. So the whole world was expecting Greece to default. The politicians were not busy trying to get elected, were trying to do something about the situation, and the whole thing was a mess. The stock market, the Greek stock market, had taken a pounding. Greek stocks were down 95% from their 2007 levels and down some 87% from their 2009 levels. After the 2008 crash, they recovered, and then the Greek problems started becoming more visible. So the overall market had dropped about 85%. Hellenic Telecom, the national telecom company in Greece, the stock, it was a blue chip, it was a large cap, it was part of the Greek index, it was also down. it was down 95% from its 2007 peak here. It was down about 87% from its 2011 peak here. So this was a price where per share stock price was under €2. And at this price, which was in the middle of 2012, in June 2012, the entire company was valued in the stock market at below 700 million euros. And the very same business was valued at several billion euros just a few years ago. So this was, when you see this, this is basically a manifestation that the stock market is expecting this company to go bankrupt. It was trading as if it would go bankrupt within the week. It was a simple telecom company that was providing fixed line telecom. It was a mobile carrier, and it provided broadband to homes and offices, broadband internet. And so the market was definitely saying that Hellenic Telecom is about to go bankrupt. So let's take a look and see whether Hellenic Telecom was actually in danger of going bankrupt. So first question was, did Hellenic Telecom borrow too much money that they now find that they cannot repay? The short answer is no, they had not borrowed too much money. These are the simplest statistics that define leverage of a company. Net debt is how much you have to pay back minus how much cash you carry. So they had to pay about $3.9 billion back. The business was generating EBITDA, earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, and amortization, the amount of money that is there to service the debt payment. It was $1.7 billion. So it had basically borrowed little over two times of what it generates. So if there were no other expenses, it will pay off all its debt with 2 years of earnings, 2 years of EBITDA. So that's a very sensible level of debt. And in normal circumstances, leverage of about 2.5 times debt to EBITDA would generally get an investment grade rating by Moody's or S&P or Fitch or any of these big rating agencies. However, in this case, because Greece, the sovereign state, was getting downgraded, Hellenic Telecom was pushed down the downgrade curve because you can't have a company rated higher than the sovereign. It's a thing with how bond markets work. I won't get into why that happens, but it's just fair enough to know that there was a effect of a downgrade that was pushing Hellenic Telecom's bond ratings down. And that downgrade had nothing really to do with Hellenic Telecom. It had everything to do with the Greek sovereign state being downgraded because of the bond crisis. So that was the backdrop. So the answer to this question was no, they were not over leveraged. So could it be that they have a temporary shortage of cash? And because they have temporary shortage of cash, they don't have enough money in their pocket to pay back the upcoming bonds and debt commitments that they have. And if they cannot pay back their lenders in time, that automatically pushes the company into bankruptcy. Is that going to be the case? Maybe it's not a solvency problem, it's a liquidity problem. So let's take a quick look. So we're in the middle of 2012, June 2012. They had actually 2 million euros that they had to pay back. You don't really see it in this. They had nearly 2 billion euros to pay back in approximately 18 months. The market was basically worried sick that Hellenic Telecom will run short of cash to honor these 2 billion euros repayment, and as a result will be pushed into bankruptcy. That was what was going on, and that's what had caused this. So let's unpack that a little bit. So in 2013, in 18 months time, they had to pay out 2 billion euros. They already had 1.4 billion euros, 1.3 billion euros. And that was in the form of cash, some German government bonds and some highly dated, short dated securities that they can convert into cash in a short period of time. These were not Greek government bonds. They were German and French and other highly rated EU government bonds. Short dated, so it's cash-like. So they had cash. They had something that could convert into cash very, very fast. And that whatever you see is the number here, very close to that number. And they had just sold a unit, a subsidiary that they owned, Telecom Serbia. And as a result, they were expecting this money to hit their bank accounts anytime. So if you add these three up, they had about 1.3, 1.4 billion euros. What was required is 2 billion. So they were short by about 600 million euros. Now, like I said, because of a Greek crisis, access to debt, equity, or any form of capital to anybody connected to Greece was a big no. So the market was basically worried that given the backdrop of the crisis, they will not be able to get their hands on 600 million euros. And as a result, they'll run short of money and they will have to go bankrupt. That was going on. So let's see where it can get 600 million euros from. These are their options. I'll walk you through very quickly one by one. Cash generated by the business. Well, Hellenic Telecom was a telecom company, right? And it generates cash. So if you go by their past recent record, operating cash flow and free cash flow, note that in the crisis, they had increased their free cash flow by cutting CapEx. They can do something like this also in 2012. And there is reason to believe that the business can generate some of or all of the 600 million euros that is required. Now, you and I don't know for sure, but it looks possible that this business has the ability to generate at least some of the 600 million euros required in 18 months' time. So that was one option. Well, can it sell something and raise some money? HTO had business units, Greece, Romania, Bulgaria, and Albania, and they had just sold Serbia. So they were present in the Balkans. Greece, their presence in Greece was the most important. 2/3 of the revenues and EBITDA that they generate came from Greece. 1/3 came from these small European countries, Romania, Bulgaria, Albania. But just like they had sold Telecom Serbia ownership stake that they had, it's possible that they could sell some of this. this had nothing to do with the Greek crisis. These were business units outside of Greece, and they were relatively unaffected by the Greek crisis. So let's see if they were to sell something here, if they'll get enough money to pay off that 600 million to cover the piggy bank. So what we know is they sold Telecom Serbia. Hellenic Telecom owned 20% of Hellenic Telecom Serbia. And to sell this 20% back to the Serbian government, they got paid 397 billion euros. So that values, if you're getting nearly 400 million euros for 20%, then the whole business is worth an enterprise value of nearly 2 billion. It's just this divided by this. So there was cold hard cash that was passing between informed industry people that valued a telecom business at nearly 2 billion euros. And this business was generating 900 million in revenues and 350 million in EBITDA. So that translates into 2.2 times revenues and 5.6 times EBITDA. That's the valuation at which this transaction happened. And this is important because the buyer was the 80% owner of Telecom Serbia, the Serbian government. They knew everything about this business. The seller was Hellenic Telecom. They are a telecom company. They knew everything about this business. Both of them agreed that this was a fair price. So if you apply the same transaction multiples to the four biggest units they had outside of Greece, this is the kind of valuations you get. And the range is because, you know, you don't look at a single number, you look at an average over the last few years, some expected numbers and so on. But you can see that if they were to sell either this or this or this, they will have 600 million euros easily. If you were to take all the non-Greece business and you were to put a market price on them, this market price, you'd get a number which is like 2.5 to 3 billion euros. So the short answer to this question is, if they were to sell something, will they raise enough money? That I can, as you can see, yes, they can. Well, what are the other options? They can refinance the existing debt. In normal situation, that would have been very easy to do. This was a very well-established company in a critical business, state-backed. And so they would, if nothing else, raise money from, be able to borrow money from the Greek banks. But now the Greek banks are in trouble and the government is fighting for survival. So it's not a normal time. So maybe they don't have this option today, but in a normal time, just rolling over their maturing debt with new debt would have been normal course of business for a company like Hellenic Telecom. The business was actually doing quite well in 2012, but it didn't seem to matter. What another notable point is, the biggest shareholder in Hellenic Telecom was Deutsche Telekom. They owned 40%. The Greeks take on 10% and the public float was 50%. In 2012, when this was going on and there were all this speculation that Hellenic Telecom will go bankrupt, Deutsche Telekom put out a public announcement. They basically effectively said, what's in this blue box? That if Hellenic Telecom is fine, it will manage to raise money on its own. But in case they cannot raise the money, we will lend it to them. That's what they said in black and white in a public forum in an investor release that they put on their website. This is clearly a game changer. It's saying that Deutsche Telekom is saying that Hellenic Telecom will not default because it's in Deutsche Telekom's interest, because their 40% stake will go worthless if the company defaults. So Deutsche Telekom, lots of zeros attached to their balance sheet, definitely have a lot of money available in order to help the Hellenic Telecom. They effectively said HTO is not going to default. When they said this, Deutsche Telekom bonds started rallying. They went from like 60 cents on the dollar to 90 cents on the dollar. But the stock market seemed to have missed the message. The stock was below 2 euros, like I said. Entire business was worth less than 600 million euros, 700 million euros. So this was a case of very high volatility. The markets were going crazy. The stock was going crazy. But it was a case of very low risk of permanent loss of capital. Why? Because Big Brother here said, I will lend them the money if they don't have the money. So no default. We started buying. Actually, we started buying the day after the Greek election results came out. So that uncertainty was resolved. So actually what happened was the stock was trading at around 1.4 euros per share. Election results came out and the stock zoomed to about 2.25 euros. That was like a 50% jump in one day. But never mind. We started buying because we thought it was a company going away for free. Despite all the volatility, there was really no permanent risk that you'll lose the money here. We put on a big position. And did we get a cheap price? Well, this was the market valuation at 2 euros a share, or slightly below 2 euros a share, about 700 million euros. Using the same Telecom Serbia transaction multiples, you get a range which is in the order of 5.5 to 7 billion euros for the all of the Hellenic Telecom. That's like a 10x difference. And if you take AT&T and Vodafone, British Telecom, and you look at all the valuation multiples those guys trade at, and you apply to what those multiples would value the earnings of Hellenic Telecom to be, we got a range. But this is, I don't put a lot of confidence in this kind of a valuation because this can be garbage in, garbage out. For example, at this time, AT&T was trading at 50 times earnings. There's no telecom company that deserves a 50 times earnings multiple. That was because of something unusual going on with AT&T. So if you apply a 50 times multiple to earnings of Hellenic Telecom and say, hey, it's worth $50 billion euros, that's not really the case. So take this with a pinch of salt, but take this more importantly, because industry experienced people were willing to pay this amount of money. So this is a 10x difference. So did we get a bargain? Yeah, we got a big bargain. So what happened? Well, time passed. HTO did not default in 2012 or 2013 or 14 or any of the following years. What they did was they were able to use the cash flow from the business and use their ability to access the market. They did manage to open up the access to capital markets again. And they managed to refinance this mountain of 2 billion and push a big chunk of it down to 2018. So this got chopped in half, if you like. So there was about 700 million here, and they pushed the refinanced with new bonds that took away this burden and put it out in the future. And they already had 1.3 billion, if you remember. So they comfortably paid off this, and they adjusted the liabilities profile to be more flexible for their purposes. So not only did they avoid default, they did not have to go to Deutsche Telekom with a begging bowl. They managed on their own to refinance the terms of their near maturing bonds and spread out the maturities with refinancing. And so they ended up coming out of the crisis, this crisis, with a much better capital structure. A few months later, in 2013, they announced the sale of Global, which was the mobile carrier, the number three mobile carrier in Bulgaria, for 700 million euros to Telenor, you know, which is the national telecom company of Norway. And we had valued Global at around 450 to 850. They managed to sell it at 770. So valuations were kind of spot on. The thing I want to point out is this was not an Amazon. This was not an Apple. This was not a Google. This was not some fantastic business that was drowning in earnings and cash generation. This was essentially a mediocre business. A telecom company in a commodity market where, whether in Greece or UK or Switzerland, the fixed line telephone business is clearly declining. People just don't even have landlines anymore. They prefer to carry a mobile phone in their pocket instead. So this business is slowly dying all over the world. It's also the case with Hellenic Telecom. This was a tough business. Mobile is a commodity in Europe. You have too many carriers competing for the same consumer. So there's a lot of price competition. There's a lot of what people call churn, and average revenue per user keeps falling down. So yeah, even this was a tough business, the mobile business. And the broadband internet was, it sucks money. You need to put a fiber cable everywhere before you can generate a dime of revenue from this business. And so this is a business that requires a lot of capex. And once you spend that capex, then you get a new fiber that your competitor will be able to put down at a fraction of the cost that you put down. So, you know, it's a damned if you do and damned if you don't kind of a business. So whichever business you look at, which made up Hellenic Telecom, they were not in this fantastic Facebook, Amazon type of businesses. It was all tough businesses. What actually had happened was event-driven investing. We had identified an event which had caused a big dislocation. We had found that the risk of our downside to our investment is small. And so all the other possibilities were big and upside. So what happened was, when the markets calmed down, this was around the time Deutsche Telekom announced, the bonds had rallied to some 80 cents. Then the markets calmed down further. All their bonds went back to par, 100 cents on the dollar. The stock, we started buying here. Remember I said it was 1.3, and by the time we bought it, it was well over 2. Then it dropped a bit. We were buying in this region. The stock tripled from 2 to 8, 2 to 6, and close to 8 in 1 year. And despite the fact that this was a mediocre business, what had happened was big dislocation, lots of mispricing. Our downside was small. We went in big and we sat there unleveraged. Bring all the volatility. This will happen, but eventually it now calms down. Yeah, we were buying somewhere here and selling somewhere here. And in retrospect, we were kind of, we should have just sold at the end of 1 year. We thought we're getting better at selling, but back in 2012, we thought it was worth much more. So we held on, took this drawdown, wait for the recovery, and we sold out somewhere around 12 euros a share. So 2 euros to 12 euros was a 6 times growth in a business in 2.5 years in a stock. 6 times multiply, you know, growth of your money in 2.5 years in a pretty mediocre business. That, if you like, is a kind of opportunity you get with event-driven investing. Even an Apple wouldn't have generated 6 times your money in 2.5 years. So here's a quick checklist. Big disruption. Yes, tick the box. Chance of a permanent loss of capital. Tiny. Why? Because of Big Brother. Future outcomes. It was impossible to predict what the future would look like, but you could see various scenarios, and all the scenarios that we could foresee were good for our investment results. So there's a saying that if when you find low downside risk, low permanent loss of capital, and big uncertainty, you're buying a call option. That is true. So the whole thing was like a call option. Finally, nothing I talked about so far had much to do with interest rates or the Greek bailout. Yeah, there were kind of side influences. The only thing that had to happen was HTO had to avoid a default and we'd make money. So this was company specific events. It was not about EU cutting a good deal, anything of the kind. And catalysts, avoid bankruptcy, you could track and see and quantify and know when you're right and know when you're wrong. So this was an event-driven investment. It ticked all these boxes, and that was the outcome. Well, I put this slide in because some people in the audience usually, I've received comments that say, you talk about an investment that is from 2012. What is the point? We're in 2021. I was talking about the method. I was talking about the investment approach. And over the years, as we applied this approach, we found extremely rewarding investments. Just a small list of those. So the point of this slide is to say the approach works. And if you do the work, you'll be able to identify this kind of opportunities time and again. Well, it doesn't come across every day, but if you keep doing the work, you'll find quite a few, enough to put half your money into in a portfolio. Here's a recent one. I put up this because this number catches everybody's attention. And it's a true number. That's a screenshot. So yeah, we did make this kind of return. And it was from a household name, Dell Computers. You can read the whole thing at your leisure. Because I've written 2 big articles. One of them, the first one got published in Barron's. The second one is just a follow-up. And you can verify the events yourself. So that's another case where this approach led to a really beautiful investment result. Process. This is what we look for when we look for event-driven investment. Is there a big disruption that will generate a mispricing? and a big misprice. Do company specific events, not external things, not competitive things, not interest rates, not Donald Trump, that will change the investment thesis. We look for a stable business, not the one that changes for this kind of an investment. And the rest of it, pretty straightforward. I think I've highlighted all these points here using the example of Hellenic Telecom. Like I said, we use this approach, we do the work every day, and once in a while, we find some outstanding investment opportunities as a result of these. And the thing I've noticed is you find these opportunities, whether or not people think the stock markets are high, stock markets are low, volatility is high, interest rates are uncertain, inflation is coming. Doesn't matter, because the investment thesis is driven on the basis of company-specific events. And that's why these are a good offset to a portfolio. This kind of investment generate diversification of risk factors in our portfolio. This is one of the other reasons we do it. So we've beaten the market pretty substantially. Wish I could show you the numbers, but because of regulations, we have to keep the numbers masked. I'm happy to send it one-on-one. And a big reason for this outperformance is also because of having a big allocation to a reasonable allocation to event-driven investments throughout the period we've been investing. So with that, wish you all a lifetime of very successful investing. And these are my contact information. If you have questions, you're interested in becoming a client, just want to say hello and get to know us, we would love to be in touch, get in touch. My contacts are here. Please feel free to drop in, send a message, or ask for a phone call, whatever be the appropriate context. So I'll take a drink of water and I'll take any questions that you may have.
Perfect. Thank you so much. I also show at the beginning of the presentation how to be in touch also directly with Anand, and also here in the slide again, Anand show how to reach out. So extremely interesting. So I'm grateful for all the insights provided during this webinar. So thank you very much, Anand. And for all our attendees, the recording will be available on our YouTube channel and in our blog, swissquote.com. But please take your time in case you want to ask some questions now directly to Anand. And feel free to contact Anand directly if you want to receive the slides, but also to have a chat and maybe directly if you also want, in case, to get more information for these opportunities that Anand offer to invest directly with the GFM Focus. Also, Patricia in the chat says, thank you, very insightful. Yeah, it was a great presentation as usual. And yeah, regarding Swissquote, I already said a lot. We are also very active on the social media, on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram. So you find us everywhere. In case you want to contact Anand, this is LinkedIn and the email. So you find here all the different solutions, different possibilities. So thank you again, Anand. It was a great webinar with a lot of insights. So thank you so much. It's always a pleasure to have these webinars, this session with you.
The pleasure was mine, Stefano. Thank you so much for organizing it, for inviting everybody, and for running the event. Appreciate all the hard work. I hope it was somewhat useful to the people in the audience. It's an acquired taste to get comfortable with event-driven investments and jump into volatility. But I think
thank you for staying till late, because I know that you are in Hong Kong, so it's late. It's nighttime, and we receive, so you can stay a little bit late. We receive a couple of questions, so three now. The first is from Andre. Thank you. How do you see current China stock meltdown? Is this an event-driven investing opportunity?
Well, like I said, the first thing we look for is there are different investment types. And basically, we're in the business of first recognizing if you're looking at an elephant, or we're looking at a horse, or we're looking at an eagle. And if you're going to try and recognize an event-driven opportunity and then try to start researching or analyzing it as an event-driven opportunity, then the first thing you have to see is whether it fits these conditions. So if you're talking about China, is there a big disruption? If you're talking about new regulations and the crackdown on tech companies and real estate companies, yeah, there is something big happening in those sectors. Now, the second thing, if you take, I don't know, Tencent, for example, and say, okay, so will company-specific events directly matter? Well, if the government is going to come and regulate how the tech business of Tencent is going to run, that's not really company-specific event. In the case of Hellenic Telecom, all they had to do was avoid bankruptcy. In the case of some of the other ones, you can pinpoint what has to happen for you to get a good or a bad investment result. In this case, it's kind of not really possible to say what company-specific events have to happen in Tencent for you to make money. And is the business stable or changing? Well, if the government is going to break up the tech companies, then clearly it's going to be changing, right? And therefore, because these things are hard to quantify, you can't really get to this answer. And if you can't get to this answer, you can't get to any of these other answers. So maybe this is true, but it's not really the case with these things. So I have a question.
Yeah, another question from Anna. How do we invest with GFM Focus, and what is the minimum amount?
The minimum amount is somewhat flexible, but most of the time we tend to open accounts for about 200,000 euros or $200,000 approximately. But like I said, we are somewhat flexible, but there are three considerations. If the amount of money is small, then we cannot actually even build a portfolio. If you give us $10,000, and I was talking about Tencent, approximately 50 US dollars a share is the current price, somewhere there. So if you give us, I don't know, $10,000, we have to buy, and we want to buy Tencent for you, I'll have to buy 100 shares. That's $5,000. Half your money is on one stock. We can't construct a balanced portfolio. Not only that, every portfolio that we manage eventually turns out to be very close to each other or close to identical. On day one, yours will be cash in, an old portfolio will be fully invested. But over a period of time, we make the same investment across all our portfolios that we manage. In the same proportion.
It's better to have a chat directly with you, so Anna can reach out without any problem, I think. Nicholas is asking, how do you make sure to find these mispriced companies? Do you use screeners? Thanks for the presentation.
I mean, you can use a screener to see if there's a big stock price change or a big news headline that might affect a lot of things. But then to answer the rest of the questions, you'll have to dig deep. I don't think you'll be able to answer the question of, is your risk of permanent loss low, by looking at a screener. You'll see numbers. You'll have to really get into the dynamics of the situation. And in this case, for example, everything changed for us when we saw this. We did look at cash generated by the business. Maybe they can, maybe they cannot. We looked at the assets they could sell. Yeah, they can sell, but who's going to buy it? What if they cannot sell it in time? And then there was this announcement that said, if they don't have the money, we'll give them the money. That means no default. That means permanent loss is zero. So therefore, we will invest. But which screener will give you this level of comfort? You cannot. You have to start looking into it before you can get to this checklist and answer these questions. So a screener might help in identifying, I don't know, 50 stocks that you look at, but then you actually have to look through each of the 50 stocks to get the one or two or three. This is what we do all day. This is why it's a full-time job for us.
Very last question from Steven. What event-driven investments did you get wrong and why?
We have gotten investments wrong. Obviously, we have. So I'm trying to think of one that fits this question. Yeah. We invested in the Dow DuPont spin-off. I don't know if you know that story. So, you know, there's a very old chemical company in the US called Dow Chemicals. There's a very old chemical company in the US called DuPont. So there were two activist investors. They came up with this plan of merging Dow and DuPont, combining it into one company, and then splitting it into three different companies. So all that happened. So now today, after this, after the breakup, Dow is into bulk commodity chemicals, DuPont is into specialty chemicals, and it's slowly shrinking itself. And Corteva was the spin, was the part of Dow DuPont that came out that is into GMO seeds and fertilizers. So that investment didn't really work out. We didn't lose money, but we didn't make money either. The reason it didn't work out was everything that was needed for this investment to become a spectacular success was there. Corteva's biggest competitor was Monsanto. And I think most of you know what happened to Monsanto and Bayer that bought Monsanto. They're drowning in their own troubles in order to survive, then forget about trying to win market share in the market. Their second biggest competitor was Syngenta, which is a Swiss company, which was bought by ChemChina a few years ago. And ChemChina is so over leveraged that they're running at a debt to EBITDA of like 8 times or something. If it wasn't China, it would be bankrupt long back. And you had Corteva, which had Dow Pioneer and so on. So nothing happened. These guys were, later we analyzed this thing and we found out the problem was too many people waiting for retirement. Nobody wants any change. They don't want to win. They just want, you know, they just want to pass their time and go back home. So even though there was like a kingdom for them to take, They were not taking it. They were busy playing golf. So yeah, we didn't make any money. We got that one wrong. Management culture.
Thanks for all the questions. And again, in order to get in touch with GFM and with Anand directly, these are the contacts. So again, thank you very much and take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye.